I am super duper excited about this tutorial. This is the Smock Bishop tutorial. I've had this on my computer for a very long time now, and I'm excited to get this video done and out. And this is like any other of my sewing videos. This is just the way I've been putting them together. There's multiple ways to put together smock bishops, as there is many other things in sewing, and this is just the way that I have been putting them together. I have put them together just about every single way that is possible to put these things together. And like I said, this is just my current favorite way. If you ask me in about a year from now, I might have a different process. I don't know, but I've been putting these together this way for about 6 months now, and it's my favorite so far. So let's get into this. And this smock bishop tutorial is the one with the pleated arms. It's not the one with the angel sleeves. First, you're going to want to iron your fabric and then lay out your pattern pieces. Now, it's really important when you lay out your pattern pieces that the top of the neckline is the same spot in the fabric. So for example, I'm using dotted Swiss for this tutorial, and I'm going to want the dot to be in the same location at the neckline. That way, when I sew down the side seams, the dots will be in line. So if you're dealing with anything of stripes or patterns or whatever, you're going to want to be mindful of where you put your pattern pieces, because you're going to want the neckline for the front, the sleeves, and the backs to all be in the same place on that pattern. I hope that makes sense. And if your fabric will rip, you are really going to want to rip your fabric, because you're going to want your fabric to be on grain for smock bishop. It'll help your fabric go through the pleater better. The only exception with that is that if you have a printed fabric that hasn't been printed true to the grain, then you're going to want to kind of make it look better according to the print. So if your print is off from the grain, you're going to want to go off so that you're on the pattern. And I hope that makes sense. Because otherwise, when you go to pleat it, what will happen is when you go through the pleater, the pattern will be out of alignment to each other and it won't look very good at all. And something else to be mindful of when you're cutting out your pattern pieces, the armhole area, you want to cut as straight as you can. So you don't want to go off at a little crooked angle or anything like that, because any amount of angle off from 90 degrees is going to add an error when you go to pleat, and you might have more pleats going down your bishop or going up your bishop, whichever way your fabric has been slanted, and then your smocking won't line up with the design. Now once you have your front sleeve and back pieces cut out, you're also going to need to cut a strip for the placket, and I'll just tear a 2-inch strip that I know is going to be longer than I need, so I don't have to think about measuring it. I just rip her out and that's that. And in addition to that, you're also going to want to cut a strip on the bias. Refer to your pattern to see how long to make that strip. So since the sleeves are smocked for this bishop, you're going to want to pleat the sleeves before sewing them. And because I'm using dotted Swiss, I'm pulling out the little dots from the section of fabric that's going to go through the pleater. Technically, you don't have to do this. You do risk breaking a needle depending on how nice your dotted Swiss is. If it's more on the nice side, then you probably aren't going to break a needle. But it does look, in my mind, kind of sloppy if you keep those little dots in there. So I think the general consensus in the heirloom world is to just pull the little suckers out. So once I had those sections pulled out, I ironed them and then rolled them up on my dowel so I could put them through the pleater. And I pleated them both at the same time so I wouldn't have to re-thread my needles in between sleeves. And then I pull them out. You want to make sure to have enough thread in those sleeves so you can lay them flat. So to finish the edge of the sleeve up, I attached some lace. And the way that this works is you put it about 1/4 inch away from the edge of the sleeve and you do a tight zigzag. The settings for my machine were a 0.6 length and a 1.8 width. And once you start that zigzag, that excess fabric will just sort of roll into the zigzag. Then you're going to want to press that sleeve and press that little bit of fabric towards the sleeve. That way it's not showing underneath the lace. So now we're going to start constructing the bishop. And like I said, there's many ways to do this. I prefer a French seam, a very, very tiny French seam. So I'll put my fabric wrong sides together and I will stitch just as parallel as I can to that edge. Like I said, any amount of air here potentially adds an uneven amount of pleats to your bishop. So you want to be mindful to be as parallel to those edges as possible. And then I will trim so close to those stitches. And I'm being mindful not to cut the threads of the stitches, of course, because that would ruin those stitches there, that seam. But you just want to cut, maybe a 1/32 over from those stitches. Then you want to take it over to your iron and very carefully iron this over and then together. You don't want to pull too hard at this point since you only have a 1/32 or so of fabric on the other side of that seam. So now I take it back to my machine and I sew just on the outside of those raw edges to enclose this French seam. and that makes the French seam like a 16th of an inch. You can see it's about a halfway between the eighth mark, so it's about a 16th of an inch. Very, very, very tiny, and these things go through my pleater like butter. I never have to worry about a needle breaking. I haven't had a needle break since I started way back when, 4 years ago. So once you complete that for the other three seams, now you're ready to pleat it, kind of. If you're using dotted Swiss like me, now you're gonna have to go and pick out all those little dots for the area that's gonna be pleated. But if you aren't using dotted Swiss, you can skip this part and go straight to the pleating. So when I was ready to pleat my fabric, I folded it in two and then ironed the top of it. This meant that I was ironing a crease into the very middle of the bishop. Then I used three pieces of scotch tape to align the fabric onto that dowel. You want to try to align that fabric as evenly as possible, and then just start rolling the dowel. It's not critical that your fabric stays taut, but it is somewhat important that your fabric stays in line. I mean, you can alter your fabric a little bit as it goes through the pleater, so if you're, say, an eighth of an inch, a quarter of an inch off from being in line on the dowel, it's not a huge deal because you can kind of alter that as it goes through the pleater, but you want to try to stay as close as you can without stressing too much. So you just keep rolling her up. And you can see when I get to a sleeve, I'll sort of align the bottom of that sleeve on the dowel like so, and then I'll just continue rolling. The number of needles you're going to have in your pleater is going to vary on the size bishop you're making and your personal preference on how many rows you want to smock. But once you have the desired number of needles in there and they're all threaded, now you can start to pleat your fabric. I like to align my fabric up with the notch just to the right of the furthest needle to the right. I hope that makes sense. And using that notch helps me keep this in line. So you're going to pleat a little bit, pull it off the needles, pleat, pull it off the needles, until you get to the very end. At which point you're going to pull it out with a bunch of excess thread, because you're going to want to have more thread than less. It's easier to cut away excess thread than it is to try to get thread that you don't have. So just pull it out with the gobs of thread, and that's sort of the nature of this beast. Now this is the bishop board that I have. I got it from Farmhouse Fabrics, and I will leave a link in the description box to where you can purchase one from them. I have found it extremely useful. I've had it for about 3 years or so. I used to just try to use the printouts that would come with patterns, and those were pretty much a nightmare to try to match up and get everything to stay, because you can't really pin it to anything. So I would try to pin it to my ironing board and it would work so-so, and I thought, I'm doing enough of these bishops that I think I've worn the $50 or whatever this cost. I can't remember off the top of my head. So I sucked it up and I paid the money, and I am very glad that I did. This is so useful, and on the other side it has a bunch of designs for lace shaping. So it's super duper useful, and I've been thrilled with the purchase. So moving on to blocking the bishop, you can see that they have all of the seams laid out for you on this blocking board along with the neckline sizes. So you just match it up to whatever size you're making and match all those seams and pin it in place. I'll just do a rough pin as you're seeing here, and then I'll take one center back and then I'll pull out the pleating threads about an inch away from the edge, or whatever your pattern calls for. You do that in order to make the back go together correctly. Every pattern's a little bit different. But I will take those threads and I will knot them together in groups of twos or threes. Once that's done, I'll pull out the pleating threads from the other side. Again, the amount of pleating threads to pull out is designated by your pattern piece. So pull these out, and then I kind of trim them up if they're just uber duber long so they're not such a mess. And then you're gonna work on pulling these, so you're gonna kind of hold the neckline in place while you pull on each one. I found that it's easiest to pull on one individually, and you might have to go through this multiple times. So you'll do like one round where you pull on every single one, then you'll go back and pull on every single thread again, and you'll sort of just repeat that process until the bishop looks nice. Now be careful that after the fact when you're pulling, make sure that that neckline is still at the line that it should be at for your smocking board. Sometimes that neckline can shimmy on up, so it's actually a smaller circumference than what you need. Just be mindful of that, and if that's the case, just shimmy it on down. But once that is all done, you can knot the other set of threads in groups of twos or threes, and then cut off the excess. Now, some women will take an iron at this point, and they will just steam the heck out of their bishop, and they will leave it on this blocking board until it has dried, like maybe overnight or so. I've done this a handful of times, and honestly, I haven't found too much of a difference between doing this or not, so generally I will skip that step. And that brings us to the neck binding. And I know if you've ever done a smock bishop, this is probably one of the things that gave you a little bit of a challenge. It definitely gave me a challenge when I first started, that is for sure. And while my neck bindings aren't perfect, I'm pretty happy with how they turn out, and this is how I do them. I do them by back smocking that first holding row. I know that back smocking takes a little bit more time, but I found that I don't like the results that are given by faster methods, so I just take the time to back smock that first holding row, and that works well for me. And you have to remember, the neckline is a pretty dominant feature on these smock bishops, so you want them to look as neat as you can make them. It's not something you just want to rush through. Alright, and then I took the sleeves and I pulled up the threads on each side about 1.5 inches, and then tied those threads off in groups of 2s or 3s. Then I pulled the threads on the other side so they matched the distance designated by the pattern, and I tied those threads off in groups of 2s or 3s. And before I did the side seams, I am pulling out the dots that are going to be enclosed with the French seam because I don't want to add any bulk to those French seams. So again, for a French seam, it is wrong sides together, then sew, then trim your excess, iron or over, and stitch that to enclose the French seam. I like to start at the bottom of these dresses. Whenever I start at the arms, it just gets off of alignment from my machine and I'm not happy with the results. So I will always start at the bottom of the dress when I do the second pass of the French seam. Alright, and you're going to do the same thing for the back, except for the back you're not going to put your French seam all the way to the neckline since that's where your placket is going to go. So you're going to move it down to the length designated by your pattern and then put your French seam in. Now to do the placket, you're going to take your placket strip. So you're going to have these two right sides together, and I like to have the placket strip on the bottom and the dress on the top. That's my personal preference. And then I like to start these stitches about 1/2 inch away from those pleats. That's going to give you about 1/2 inch of space where you can put your hand-done buttonhole later on, or whatever method you decide to close this bishop with. As you continue down that placket, you're going to have to angle the dress off to the side. That way you won't have bunches of fabric caught in those stitches looking like a hot mess in your placket. So you'll get down to the bottom of the placket, put your needle down, lift your foot, adjust your fabric as needed so you avoid stitching bunches to your placket, and then you'll continue sewing. When you continue sewing on this side, I like to have my stitches just as close as I possibly can next to those pleats. This way you're minimizing the gap between the pleats, which minimizes the gap between your smocking, so your smocking looks more like a continuous design. I personally like that look. And when you're done sewing your placket, you're going to make a snip at the bottom of your placket, being careful not to go through those stitches, and that will release the tension at the bottom. Then you can trim up those uneven seams for your placket, and then I like to iron my placket 1/4 inch over, and then fold it 1/4 inch and iron again. At this point, your placket strip should be in line with those stitches. And then the last thing I'll do to my placket is I'll fold the placket 1/2, and then I'll just put a handful of stitches at the very bottom of the placket at maybe a 45 degree angle or so. And these handful of stitches just really help the placket stay flat. So then I'll just pin my placket in place because I like to do my hand sewing all at once later on. So moving on to the neckband, I like the neckband to be about 2 inches in width. And then I will fold the neckband 1/2 and iron it like you're seeing here. And then I will start to sew the neckband onto the neck. Now I sew this right side together with the raw edges in line. Also, you're going to want about 1/2 inch of the neckband sticking out. And that 1/2 inch is how you're going to hand sew the neckband down to enclose those edges. And that'll make some more sense later when I show you how I do that. So I just take my time and I sew right along those stitches that I did my back smocking. You just want to go slowly, make sure those pleats stay in line. Like I said, this is a very obvious spot of the bishop, and so if this doesn't look good, it just sort of goes downhill from here. You don't want to put all of your time into smocking something where the neckline doesn't look good. So once you have that sewn, you're going to want to cut just enough so that you can take that binding strip and wrap it over to the other side so that folded edge of the binding strip is in line with those stitches. You don't want to cut too much fabric that's going to go underneath that neck binding though, because then the neck binding will just sort of collapse, for lack of a better explanation. And even though your neck binding might be on the bias and it might be fine technically wise, that little bit of fabric underneath the neck binding helps to keep it poofed out. And here you can see a neck binding I did many years ago where I didn't do this. I cut too much of the fabric out from that neck binding, and you can see even though it could lay flat because there's no fabric underneath of it, it just sort of collapsed and it doesn't look good. It doesn't have the fabric underneath it to keep it poofed up, if that makes sense. And at this point, I'm ready to do my hand sewing and then my smocking. I personally like to have a mostly completed garment before I do any of my smocking, if not all the way completed. Many times I will do every other step except for smocking before I begin smocking these bishops. So here I am hand stitching the folded edge of that neck binding down, and you can see I took that little half inch or so section and I folded it towards the neckline and then folded the neck binding down on top of that. And then as far as my thread goes for all of the hand sewing, I use a lighter weight thread. It's typically around a 70 or 80 weight cotton thread, and I will tie the thread into the stitches from the neckline, and then I will go from the stitches of the neckline to that folded edge, and that's how I will sew that neck binding down. Then I'm doing the same sort of method on the back placket. So I'm taking my stitches from the stitches that are holding the placket in there, and then I'm bringing it up to the placket strip. And at this point, these bishop projects usually go into a plastic bag, like a Ziploc bag, with a needle and my embroidery scissors, along with whatever floss I'm going to do the smocking with. Then I'll take these when we're going driving on long distances, or if I'm stuck at an appointment or what have you, I will just take them along with me and do a little bit of smocking here and there, and eventually the bishop will get done. Now the last complicated part of bishops that we still need to talk about is closing up that back placket. There are many different ways to do this, and I think I have done every single one of them, from hand crocheted little loops to hand sewn on snaps to machine buttonholes to those elastic loop straps that you generally use for wedding gowns. I think you name it, I have tried it. Currently, my favorite method is to do a hand done buttonhole. I would say my next favorite method is to do a hand crocheted loop. I think this is sort of, you find what works for you and what you like the look of best, and you go with that. There are many different ways to do this back. But like I said, my favorite way to do them now is the hand-done buttonholes, and I have a video on how to do hand-done buttonholes. They are not as hard as what people make them out to be like. I promise you, I taught myself, and within a buttonhole or two, I had them looking to my satisfaction. So I think you should try them. You'd be surprised how easy they are. I decided to finish the bottom of the bishop with the same lace that I used to finish the edge of the sleeves. If I didn't go this route, I would have folded the edge up according to the pattern and then folded it up again, or according to my liking, because those measurements aren't really a huge deal, especially if you're going to put bloomers on the baby. And then I would have hand stitched that in place. You really, in my mind, should not machine stitch smock bishops. Now, there are some exceptions to that rule, I think, but if it's truly heirloom, it's definitely not going to be machine stitch at the bottom. If you're just making this for a gift and you know that the person receiving the bishop is not going to appreciate a hand-sewn hemline, then by all means, you put that sucker through your machine, because you got enough time invested into this outfit for them not to appreciate those things. I'll tell you what. At any rate, there are other options you can do for your hem. You can do the multiple tucks. You can do, a bunch of other things. But once you've done your hem, then you're done with your bishop. Like I said, there's many different ways to do a bishop. I personally love the look of bishops. I think that they are just a timeless little outfit. You can dress them up, dress them down, do them in many different kinds of fabric. I love smocking them. They're just one of my favorite things to sew. And I hope you give them a try. I hope this tutorial was helpful for you. This is just the way I've been slicing the cake recently, if you will. But of course, there are many other ways to do it. If you've got any questions, just leave them in the comments and I will do my best to answer them. As always, we thank y'all for watching and we will catch y'all next time.